Good morning and welcome to the Piano Masterclass from the third series of the RMBS Masterclass series. Absolutely lovely to be here. I'm Band Sergeant Andy Hall. Let's show you a little video. Good morning. So that was a theme from The Matrix that we performed at the Royal Albert Hall at the Manhattan Festival of Music a couple of years ago now. So as I mentioned before, I'm Band Sergeant Andy Hall and I'm currently the piano instructor at the Royal Marine School of Music in Portsmouth. Now today I'd like to take you through a little bit about me, my musical path, then a little bit about my career, and then like the title suggested, I want to try and give you a few things, tips and tricks that you can use, things that I've learned along the way that have made me a more versatile pianist and essentially made me ready for some of the things that get thrown your way as a gigging pianist, really. So no two days are the same. So let's get straight into it. So a little bit about me, really. So I'm originally from Peterlee in County Durham, a very proud northerner. And it was there that I really sort of cut my teeth as a musician, my sort of passion for wind bands, I guess, was ignited at that point. I was in the Durham County Wind Ensemble for a number of years, and then from there I then went on to study BA Honours at Newcastle University. So getting towards the end of uni is kind of choice time, and I couldn't really decide where I wanted to be, whether I wanted to go into teaching or whether I wanted to gig for a little while I was sort of young. So I started looking at different employment opportunities, and in the end I had a bit of a shortlist. So the cruise ships was one of them because I was young and I wanted to travel. Blackpool Tower Ballroom randomly was in there. The teaching opportunity, so going for the PGCE and then going into teaching full time. And then I was doing a gig one day, and as something you're not always using the whole concert, and I was flicking through a Muso magazine, if any of you have used that, I was flicking through there and there's an advert for the Marines. And I thought, well, let's explore this and see what it's all about. At the time there wasn't a lot of exposure for the Royal Marines Band in the Northeast, so I didn't really know that much about it. So I started researching it and I thought, you know what, this sounds like it might be for me. So I applied and upon graduating in 2004, I then joined the Royal Marines Band service in September 2004 as a clarinet and a pianist. And so I went and did basic training, 15 weeks basic training, and then from then I went into my music training. I did the full time in training, and I think I needed every little bit of it. So when you're under training, you have a military instructor, which is what I do now, and then I also have a civilian professor, and I need to really attribute everything about my technique and some of the things that I'll speak about today. It all sort of comes from the professor Rob Douglas at the Royal Marine School of Music, he really sort of blew my mind with what was possible and some of the things that you can do to really sort of achieve and enhance your playing. What I would say is, whilst I'm in the crux of it, I want to try and get loads of information over to you as much as I can. You know, the piano is such a huge instrument, sort of literally and in the workload that you get given. In terms of questions, I may not be able to answer the questions the whole time, so if they end up being towards the end, then I'll try and open a question session towards the end there. So if I do miss your question, I do apologise. Back to my training. Rob's been fantastic for me. He really sort of he tore my technique apart and rebuilt it again. One of the remarks from my audition was kamikaze fingering in the on the descents of all my scales. First and foremost, we sorted that out. Then we sorted the technique out, and then we really sort of delved into building me up again and creating a better player. Having sort of passed music training, I then spent a lot of my the early part of my career in the West Country. So I served in both Plymouth and Limston band, and whilst down there, I did two operational tours of Afghanistan, they were both sort of enlightening. Whilst we were over there, we had a military role. And obviously we're all musicians, so we all want to play. So we're trying to have a musical role there as much as we can. We had a rock band that we put together, and it was a bunch of mates. For any of you who watched Sergeant Andy Platt's Masterclass on the guitar last week, he was the lead guitarist in the band. And we were just a bunch of mates who sort of got together and thought, let's just play. And then that ended up going on an op tour with us. So whilst we were there, our main role was ambulance drivers. We worked in the motor transport department. We had some guys who were vehicle commanders and drivers who would go on the combat logistic patrols, radio operators. We really turned our hands to lots of things, but we're all musicians at heart and we love gigging. To gig in Afghanistan was both surreal and rewarding experience. I'll speak about some of the big gigs that I've done over my career later on, but one of my favourite was probably just before one of the big ops was going to happen. We just rocked up outside the NAFI, which is like a military sort of area where people can go and congregate, and we just played everything from Guns N' Roses to I think Kings of Leon was the big sort of summer anthem at the time, and we just tried to keep people's minds off what was going on. And that was a real sort of early point in my career that I realised the power of music, and it made such a difference to me to sort of see what effect we can have. But I also learnt a lot from gigging with them guys, and I will go on to some of the things that we learnt just from experience and some of the things that you learn from other musicians. I then went to the Royal Marine School of Music as an instructor the first time, and then from there I undertook the year-long Royal Marines Bandmasters course, a really intensive course. Any of you who watched Lieutenant Tom Griffin's masterclass, I'm sure he spoke quite a lot about the Bandmasters course and what's involved there, and that's really enhanced me as an all-round musician. And when I come back to the piano, the things that I learned on that course have really helped just open my ears and open my mind to the possibilities that music can offer. Having finished the Bandmasters course, I then went to Romans Band Portsmouth before then returning back to the School of Music where I am at the moment. So any of you who might be thinking about auditioning or are due to audition, it'll be myself and Rob who'll be doing your audition. Just to speak a little bit about, so I mentioned at the beginning, I wanted to travel while the cruise ships was a bit of an option for me, and I've been really lucky in my service career to have travelled extensively. Some of the key places for me, USA, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, Dubai, Monaco, India, Switzerland, and they're all sort of great sort of top 10 sort of holiday locations, aren't they, as well? But other places that I've travelled, which probably wouldn't have been in my top 10, but I really enjoyed going, the Ascension Islands, and then the Falkland Islands. And it was going, we mentioned about, you know, the effect of music, you know, and they don't get a lot of live music in the Falklands, so when we go down there, it can have a real impact, which is great. And I got to see penguins, which is pretty cool. Anyway, moving on. So that's a little bit about my career. What I really want to do is delve quite quickly into a broad stroke look, really, at things that you can incorporate to becoming a more versatile pianist. And the thing I want to start with is a warm-up technique that works for me. I kind of, you know, I'm sure we've all been there and we've seen the person who sits down and they just start razzing out their favourite lick that they can play really well. And they play really fast and flashy. It's not really warming up, it just you're just practicing something that you can do already fairly well. I often treat my fingers like any other muscle in the body, and I like to start nice and gently. One thing that if you have time in your day, you know, particularly with those of you who might be locked down at the moment, you can always use this opportunity to revisit your technique as well. If you can't get your lessons in, you know, a really useful thing that you can do is you can set an iPad up like I have today, and you can use your technique and then watch back and try and revisit. After Afghanistan, I had to rebuild my technique, and I was in Plymouth and Rob was in Portsmouth, so getting back from my teacher was a little bit difficult. So I can still remember the lessons that I was given, so I'd set an iPad up and then try and watch it and try and pick up my own problems. So initially, one thing I'll often quite is sit there and just play up and down five notes, but you know, really having a lot of range of movement, and trying to have independence between our fingers. So a lot of height and then first note. And that's always the nightmare, the fourth finger. So the fourth finger will always struggle to move independently of the others, but it's one of those things that you keep doing, and if you don't do enough, then that's where you get found out, and it's one of them things that you just keep building on. And that's one of those things that you can, you know, it seems really sort of pedestrian that you're playing so slow, but having that sort of idea of, and then you'd incorporate your left hand, and then you might get a little bit quicker with it as you progress, and that's one of them. And this was something that Robin had put into my playing, because my fingers essentially, if the finger wasn't on the keyboard, it would be just, you know, just waving around doing something. It wasn't particularly efficient, and it wasn't really helping me out. So that was one thing that Rob incorporated to try and get me using my fingers as efficiently as possible. Now the other thing is scales, really. I do my scales every day that I sit at the keyboard. I must apologise for not being on the my beautiful Schimmel piano. Unfortunately, the hot weather and lack of able to get a tuner in at the moment is meant it's not particularly the best idea to play on that thing at the minute, unless I was covering a bit of Scott Joplin. So the keyboard is here, but a lot of the work we do is on keyboard, so kind of it makes sense as well. So the other thing is scales. The big thing with scales that I've noticed, a lot of people that I teach come and they kind of have this wavy finger as well. So their fingers are up here. Oh, by the way, I now need these ones, and they drop them down again, and that sort of idea. Now, the most efficient way you can be doing it is really be looking at tucking the thumb and trying to get it towards the ring finger. So as soon as you play the thumb, tuck it under, and essentially the thumb's kind of dragging you up the piano. And then as soon as you've got the thumbs down, then you've got the next notes again. So it's the thumb's ready, it's under. Needs to be a very deliberate movement, and don't worry about sort of hanging around to make the gestures right. take the time now to build that strong foundation. So you're coming down from the top, and the big thing you're going to have to do is then take your fingers over. So really, really deliberate movement. And what we're looking to do as well is be as efficient as possible. So try and bring your hand in as you need to. So you kind of don't want to be... So almost pull your, like, it's almost like a spider when you scare them and they kind of do that. So. So then when you put a bit of time, increase the tempo a little bit. Nice and even. And that's the other thing that you can use with your video. Listen to your scales. Are they even? Are their notes bulging? Some fingers are stronger than the others, so therefore you might have a bulge. So you kind of it's just exaggerating it for a point really, but you know they're the sort of things that you can be looking at and really sort of honing down on your technique. The other thing I'd like to mention really is incorporating the metronome into your practice as well. The metronome is a fantastic tool, and it's an awful punishment method as well, I think, you know. So it really sort of it focuses you and it creates a really disciplined method to your practice. And whether that be scales or repertoire, you slow things down and you use the metronome, you'll achieve your goal quicker. One thing that Rob used to speak about, and I'm guilty of it, it's the idea of end goaling things. You know, you sit at the piano and you want to be able to play that piece like yesterday, but you know, by doing that you'll never really quite have it as good as it could be. So just dial it back a little bit, practice things slowly, and then when you've got them, then just gradually up it, and you'll be surprised how much more quickly slow practice will allow you to achieve your end goal quicker, particularly with fast repertoire. So you can put the metronome on. This is just on 60 BPM at the minute. So you put that on there and then you gradually increase your scales. And then as you're doing that, your fingers are going to start getting a bit more of a warm up. Whilst I'm doing that, I'm constantly thinking, how did I play that? I'm aware that I achieved the top C ahead of the metronome, so therefore, you know, I'm rushing my own playing. So that would be something that if I was watching the video now, but okay, you're rushing it a little bit, just take your time off it a little bit more. So that's 60 BPM, and then you just gradually start increasing the tempo as you go. See it rushing there, rushing. Then you go to, and so on, and then you can just as your fingers are starting to feel good, you know, and there'll be a point where you might, oh, do you know what, I'm going to stick on 70 for a little while because it's not feeling so good, but then you get better and you keep moving past it. So just keep gradually building things up, and as you build it, you'll get quicker and quicker as the muscles would if you go about to exercise. You know, it's one thing I really quite enjoy, resistance training. So sometimes my fingers will feel a little bit not great from lifting heavy weights, and then this is a great way of just getting them more supple and more agile again. So yeah, that's scales. There's another thing you can use, and I'm a real fan of it. It's called Hannon. It's kind of one of the sort of technique methods you can use. I don't know if you can see it very well there, but essentially it allows you to they're sort of it's a whole manual of them, and then you start the first ones. probably with a metronome as well. And I can do this every day because I've got the independence to actually still talk while playing them. So you start number one, you work your way through. So the one I've just put up there for you, that's looking to work on fingers 3, 4, and 5, which inherently, you know, 3, 4, and 5 are going to be the weaker ones. You know, 1 and 5 is okay, 2 is pretty good. But we're going to be working on 3, 4, and 5. So. Again, I'd have the metronome on more often than not with this. You get the idea. And then you go up all the way up and all the way back. But Hannon, you know, if I'd really recommend that manual. You can still buy it. I think you can get a digital download of it now as well. But yeah, the Hannon's really good. And I find that works for me a lot. So then, you know, I've done my warm-up. I've got everything sort of trickling on, and then I'll probably just do a little sort of confirmatory little play. Yeah, it's feeling good. Arpeggios are probably going there as well, to be honest. But yeah, and then, okay, that's feeling nice now, and that might have a little bit of a jam through a 12-bar blues. Jam around, really, just getting my fingers going before I really then start my work. So that's kind of how I start most of my days, really. But scales and arpeggios, you know, I guess when I was younger, it was a means to an end. You needed to be able to play your scales and arpeggios to get the next grade with your grades 1 to 8, and then and it was really when I started doing this for a living that you realise how important your scales and your technique work. Just to get things moving on the morning, and then you're kind of ready for whatever life's going to throw at you. Sometimes you might have some nice easy repertoire, sometimes something's thrown in front of you and you think, oh, okay, this is a little bit more challenging. Yeah, so that's a bit about my warm-up technique. Now I'd like to move forward a little bit to versatility and the things that I've found that have made me a more versatile pianist. You know, we're all grounded within the classical repertoire a lot of the time with lessons that we get, but we need to be able to do lots of things. And I guess style is sometimes attributed to your childhood and your upbringing. And there's I've got a couple of American friends who, you know, they're serious jazz musicians, and you know, it's that their dad would play, you know, Bill Evans or Count Basie or Oscar Peterson, and you know, from the age of 3, that's what they listened to and that's what they were immersed in. I mean, for me, my mum, you know, she really enjoys, well, I'm really good at 80s power ballads, you know, just from listening to stuff in the car with. I can play power ballads all day long, and you know, a whole range of them as well, whether it be Mariah, Whitney, Gloria Estefan, whatever it might be. You know, the power ballads are the way forward. And my dad, you know, he often had the Elton John anthology on, so when we get chucked Elton John at work, yeah, I'm more than happy to play that. And I guess that a lot of it is, without me really knowing it, you're immersed in and you hear a sort of type of music all the time, so you start internalizing it, so you feel all like the inflections and the way, you know, Elton John plays with a real sort of a kind of percussive feel sometimes, and that's just something that, because I've heard it a lot, I sort of feel it, and that's what, you know, if you, as you move forward, you become a little bit older, then there'll be things that that you'll listen to, you know, and then you'll be able to hear it. I mean, when I was sort of growing up, I guess Robbie Williams did his split from Take That, so, you know, I can really play it. The sheet music you get for that, there's no resemblance to what it should sound like, but you just kind of, you just pick it up because you listen to it all the time. But then, you know, it gets to a point where there might be things that you want to learn more and you want to get better at. So for me, it was jazz. You know, we're taught quite a lot with jazz at the Roman School of Music, but I really wanted to push to the next level. And the way I did that was through active listening. So I quite often have things like Jazz FM on in the background, and it's there, and it might just be in the background, not particularly listening to it. But, you know, there'll be certain artists that I want to kind of take things from, and I'll just immerse myself in their music, and then it becomes a more active listening. You start listening, you think, okay, what can I hear? What choices is he making or she making? You know, what inflections are they playing? What emphasis are they playing? How heavy is the swing, for example, when we're looking at jazz? And all of them things you start listening to, and then you try and replicate that. You sit at the keyboard and play it for yourself. If you've got good ears, you can play along with it, or you can buy transcriptions, and you can play along, and then you really start immersing yourself in that style. And then you listen to how they're interacting with other musicians. If any of you are fans of Tower of Power, for example, you know, if you listen to their rhythm section, and you're very much a rhythm section player as a pianist, you'll hear that they don't ever play over the top of each other. You know, if the guitar player's gone crazy, you know, the keyboard player, Roger, he just backs off, and he often talks about looking for that little space, and when he finds that space, that's when it's his moment, and he puts it in there. And it's really important that you learn that, and if you learn to appreciate other players, then you become a real rhythm section. You know, at the Mountbatten Festival of Music this year, it's live on, not live, it's on YouTube if you want to watch that, but the rhythm section we had this year was, you know, it was really fun to play in, because everybody had a sort of mutual respect, no one overplayed each other, everyone appreciated each other's work, and that's just from listening, and it's huge, really. I think when we're going back to listening sort of stuff for developing yourself, you know, another thing you can be listening to is the sounds that are being used as well. I'll touch on it a little bit later, but you know, you're looking at different sounds that the keyboard players are using. So if you're moving away from being just a pianist and more of a keyboard player, you know, you're listening to what they're trying to achieve, and the sounds that they use to do it. So like I've said, I've only got an hour. Instagram sort of knock you off at an hour point, so it is a bit of a whistle stop tour. So many of the things that I'll speak about, I could pretty much do a masterclass on each of them independently. So I'll just try and give you a broad stroke look at some of the things that I incorporate into my practice. And don't get me wrong, I'm still learning. Every day is a school day for me. So what would be really useful is if I kind of go through some of the ensembles that I play within, and the band service, and then some of the stylistic challenges that places on me, and then how I overcome them, that may well help, and then we'll go from there. So I guess starting ensembles, the first one we do is we go out on our own quite a lot. As cocktail pianists, you can be, you know, some of the most lavish establishments in the country, you can end up there on your own, essentially creating an atmosphere, playing for someone's dinner or pre-dinner drinks or cocktails, as the name suggests. And a lot of that is pretty cool, because you get to choose what you want to play. As long as it's appropriate, you're setting an atmosphere, and as long as you can set that atmosphere, then that's key. You can pretty much play what you want, but I always say, you know, you should play with real emotion. So I've already said, you know, the old power ballads. I pretty much play about 3 hours of them things. There's also the classical repertoire that you can delve into, which many of our pianists do. I really quite enjoy musicals, and they're fairly well known, so people like them, or Disney tunes. But what I'd say is that when you do play these things, just play with conviction. So I mean, I don't know, let's say Les Mis. So you've got I Dream a Dream. You know, your sheet music will be. Thank you. that's pleasant. You know, someone's going to be happy to have a gin and tonic to that. But, you know, let's play with a bit of flair, you know, really sort of. You haven't got the lyrics telling you the story like you would in the musical. You've just got you playing the tune. So, you know, some real emotion, and that's cocktail piano for really. But a lot of that's just listening, you know, listening to how things are phrased. If you really know, like if you've listened to Les Mis a number of times, you kind of know, you know, how the emotion, the octaves have put that, and you put that into your music. The next thing to move on really is jazz. Jazz could have its whole series. You know, it's you mentioned jazz, you pop that can of worms, and boom, it goes. There's so many things that we could talk about with jazz, but what I would like to talk about a little bit is to dispel a myth. So those of you who are already working on jazz, I mean, I took a jazz chart up here so we can see what it's all about. So All of Me, it's a classic jazz chart. We play quite regularly within the Marines, and it's as you see, you get the chords above and then a melody line. So it's a real idea for you to just. You've got so much more license. There's not sort of dots on the page. You've got chords, and you kind of do what you want there. Now the beauty with it is once you've learned the harmony, then it kind of the world's your oyster to a point. Now there's a number of people that would need to once you've done your grounding, you've got all the foundations in there. You kind of understand it. What we find a lot of people can do the theory. They'll read the books. And then when it comes to improvising, they kind of freak out a little bit and go, oh, I can't improvise. Of course you can. And for me, an analogy that I use quite regularly, and I think it's fairly pertinent, is for me, it's a little bit like vocabulary improvising in jazz. You know, as a toddler, you know, you'll sort of learn, you know, independent words, and then eventually you put like a small little phrase together, you know, in I don't know, like a little, you know, that's just a three note throwaway sort of thing there. But you try it and you play it and people go, oh, that's cool. And it's kind of like when you say a sentence, you say something and it has a positive reaction, you're going to use that sentence again. If you say something and it has quite a negative reaction, largely you're not going to say it again. And it's the same with jazz, really. But it's been quite difficult because you're trying to come up with what sentences are going to work. Yeah, you can, you know, YouTube's great. There's loads of guys giving you different ideas. Listening again, you know, go back to listening to what the greats have done. Transcribe it if you can. But the other thing is just trying stuff out for yourself as well, and try and find your own voice. So you've used all of, you've heard all these different ideas. Now you need to just sit at the piano and have a go. And when I first started doing the jazz, it was reliant upon you know, currying favour from a bass player and a drummer to give up their evenings to come in and sit while you essentially tried out your new stuff. And you know, do they want to be doing jazz or the pub with me on a Friday night? It's a bit of a challenge sometimes. But one thing that's really sort of been a game changer for me, I mean, there's been backing tracks for a while, but there's now an app, iReal Pro. I'm sure there's others available, but that's the one that I use. And it's fantastic because it's a forum-based thing, so lots of people can delve into, they can upload versions of backing tracks of pieces. So like All of Me, for example, is a one that you can put in there. And what's great is you can, if you're a saxophonist, for example, you can leave everything in. But as pianists, you can fade out the you can fade out the piano accompaniment. It's like a comping accompaniment, which you can fade out, and then you've just got the bass and drums, and in the comfort of your own home, you try out lots of different ideas, and some of them will work, and some of them will won't. And just sitting there thrashing through loads of different ideas really sort of opened up my playing. And then I'd go for lessons. I went for lessons with a guy called Craig Milverton, who is an absolute legend jazz pianist. And he'd open up possibilities for me, but I then needed to try them out. And using this app was fantastic. Solo piano is great, but this is great for your ensemble work. So just to give you an idea of what's possible, so you can select how many choruses. So let's just do all of me because it's a good example. And it'll count you in, and then off you go, really. To go over several times, but the time is absolutely racing away. So then you play your head, and then you start just trying other things in there. You chuck things that in work, and then I'll put a chord in. You know, that works quite nicely. You try a different extension, and the ones that'll work, and the ones that won't. And that was a real game changer for me, in terms of improvising's not a dark art. It's just something that you just got to chuck yourself into and give it a go, really. That's jazz, and I guess a lot of that also goes forward to the big band side of things. Big band is, you know, you need to have that knowledge of the chord based the chord based stuff, but in addition, you also just need to have a good listening and the good stylistic awareness. I mean, something that we I guess it's not strictly big band, but the arrangement was really sort of craftily done by, craftily woven out by Colour Sergeant Nick West. He took the Gloria Estefan stuff and then made it into almost a big band chart. We did that at MFM this year. I'll just show you a quick video. So this is, it's a whole medley, but this is just goes to the whole thing sort of changes to a piano Montuno jazz feel. And I had a decent working knowledge of Latin jazz. But you know, to really sort of, you've got to be in the style, and it's got to sound so effortless, it's got to sound cool, but it's hard. So sometimes it'd be difficult. Let's just have a little listen to it, and then you have a little solo as well. So you've got all those cross rhythms going on beneath you as well, so you've got to have that inner pulse. Nick, I've just seen your question. It's iReal Pro. So at that point there, you've gone from being from the main soloist to then accompanying, and I'm just playing the groove, laying the groove down for the fantastic Cottle Mark Upton to do what he does best. So the way I approach that, really, metronome practice. I've not got the biggest hands in the world, so often I have to find little workarounds, particularly if it's octave-based stuff. So just slowing it all right down, and I get a feeling really chilled at that sort of slow tempo, and then just gradually build the tempo up, and then you maintain that relaxed feel. And you know, that's a really prudent way of doing it, because sometimes even though there's a tempo set and you practice the tempo marking on the page, when you get to the night, you know, the thrill of the night's happening, and sometimes the tempo might creep up a little bit from you know what you were trying to practice, and music just find a groove, and sometimes that groove might be a little bit quicker than you thought. So if you've done that slow sort of real grounding underneath, it's much easier to just push that another couple of BPM higher, rather than sort of you've practiced it to a set point, and you can't really go any further. Yeah, so that's jazz and big band to a point. Next thing I want to move on to is one of my absolute personal favourites, and that is function band. So we spoke earlier about, you know, having different styles and sounds, and a lot of that comes from listening, you know, and I really enjoy sort of pop and rock stuff as many people do, and listening to lots of it then allows you to be able to replicate the style, and then you get the different sounds that you want as well. So when we do function band, it's often we're there to give everyone a good time, but people expect, essentially it's covers. So this is what I learned when I was playing with the rock band Airwall. We gigged with no music, and what was great with that is you had to listen to everything, you had to transcribe it, but then you listened on a whole different level to the sounds that were needed, because people wanted the iconic sounds from different pieces and they wanted different styles. And I learned a lot from them guys, and just that way of gigging. So then now when I get given a chart for something, you know, I'll then straight away go to the track and listen to how things are done. You know, for example, so Jestlin, yeah, Jestlin is one that we do quite regularly. So the part that I got given, you know, it's a really iconic intro, but the part was. Then you go to the track, and then you realise that you need a totally different piano sound. You need like a really percussive piano sound, and it needs to have a lot of hammer to it, and the pedal needs to be down. So just them little things, like by going to the track, then you learn. The other thing is, so we touched on Robbie Williams there, you know, and Let Me Entertain You, absolutely cracking piece. But again, you need to know the inflections. And I instinctively know the bass is going to come in with the big cymbal crash, because you just internalise and know the music really well. And then you start looking forward to like the Fender Rhodes funky sounds. You know. Sort of things, because we do right across the spectrum. Essentially, we're there to give. We have some really skillful arrangers in the band, and you know, things will come into the charts, and they've already scribed it out, and we're playing stuff, and we've got some of the older, more iconic stuff. Because often within a mess dinner, for example, you'll have a whole age range from sort of early 20s to let's not mention their upper age limit, because they want like that. But you know, things like Stevie Wonder, you know, that spans all generations, but you need to know the classic clavvy sound. All them sort of things, because if you start Superstition and you don't have that sound in that style, the way Stevie plays it, it's kind of not really gonna sing. I mean, you even got Donna Summer. All that sort of stuff. And a lot of that is this function band. I love it. I've had the real privilege of playing in them and running them over the years. It's just all about style. You know, there's a few of the trainees that I've had come through, and they ask how you get to a good level with the function band. And that again goes back to just listening and having the style there. There's no such thing as you can't do function band. You just need to have a little bit of a listen and an understanding of the chords. That's pretty important. So a lot of the parts that we'll get, like the All of Me that I put up earlier, a lot of the time you'll just get a chord chart, and then you kind of make it your own from there. So yeah, that's function band. And then what I'd like to move up to now is the full wind band, the concert band, and you know, everything that we do in the smaller ensembles will often go forward to the that as well, and a lot of that is listening, understanding style, but also you know, a big thing that we need to have is that, so we've spoken about having metronome practice, but it's also developing your own internal metronome is really important. So I'd like to play you an example of something that we did at the Royal Albert Hall last year, and we did a tribute to Take That. It was that's 30th anniversary, I think it was, and one of our bandmasters, Trev Norton, he did a really great arrangement of a medley of Take That tunes, and within there we had Million Love Songs, and you know, it's a great piece, and you know, the way I approached it was it's not technically difficult. I mean, you'll see in a second, it's not, you know, you just it's not tricky, but the key to it is having that internal metronome, because if you don't set, sometimes we'll follow the conductor, and there'll be sometimes that the conductor will often give you license as a player, and you just you lay it down, and then it goes from there. This is one of these examples, and if I don't have that tempo perfect, when Colour Sergeant Gordon Carter comes in with the Melton sax solo after a few bars, if I've not set it, I've really sent him stitched him up a little bit there, because he hasn't got that sort of real nice groove to sort of base what he's doing, and you know, that's really important. So the first thing you do is you get the music up, and then straight away take that on. Okay, how do they play it? How did Gary Barlow sit at the piano and play? And you play with all the inflections and the tempo, and then I constantly revisit that tempo. You know, even like this Saturday night, so we've already performed it twice. I'm still, before I go on stage, just pressing play and just having that internal metronome going there. And the other thing to approach it with is count-ins. So I don't want to teach you to suck eggs, but this is something that I find that really helps me. So if you're in 6A, for example, yeah, you can kind of go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, or 1, 2, and yeah, that kind of works. But for me, I'm trying to count, but in the style, if that makes sense. So before Million Love Songs had happened, we'd had another piece, and that's ended. And whilst the applause is happening, I'm sat there, and immediately, rather than thinking 1, 2, 3, 4, I'm thinking dun. So then my tempo is just really solid, and the style's there, because Gordon's going to come in off one of my quavers, and you know, it was really important to me. Gordon's been kind of like a sort of mentor for me over my career. He's been really important. I've learned so much from him. It was an absolute honour to play a great piece of music, but with him at the Albert Hall, and I really wanted to nail it. So let's just have a listen to it. So now we're going to an accompanying, and I'm going to put inflections where there's gaps in the music. So every time he stops, do da do da, all the little quaver movements. They're not written, but they just need to sort of. That's where opening your ears, understanding that your part's independent of the others, then you can really become an accompanist. And you're just, like I said about Tower of Power, you're sort of just filling in little gaps, so the music always has some sort of momentum to it. And what an honour to play with two fantastic musicians, all of us as well. They're going to leave the gap here. Yeah, so there are sort of little points where you want to be filling things in, doing your own little thing there, really. So yeah, that's my Million Love Songs, probably one of my most enjoyable music experiences since I've joined the Marines. So we've spoken a lot about the job and style and all them sort of things. I hope some of that was really insightful for you. I know it's a little bit of a broad stroke, but hopefully it's just a little bit to whet your appetite and get you stuck into some of the things that we can achieve as pianists. What I would like to look at a little bit is the audition process for the Marines as well. So a lot of people ask questions about the piano category and what we're looking for, and you know, primarily we're one of the categories that has a minimum standard on the joint instructions, and I just want to cover a couple of them little things and some of the things that I might look for if I was looking for a prospective pianist. So the first thing to speak about really is the required standard. So we put grade sort of 6 to 8 on there, and that's really to give you a grounding, because the workload is really quite large. So to try and give you a good sort of technique base, to keep up with the workload for piano. That being said, you know, there's no two grade 8s the same way as there's no, you know, you pass your driving test, two people have got to pass on their driving test, one might be a much better driver than the other. And you know, in piano it's the same. You know, we'll have a number of candidates come at grade 8 standard, varying levels of grade 8 and how they've used that technique and sort of taking things forward. So what I would say on that one, just because you haven't necessarily achieved your grade 8, don't think that necessarily we're not an option open to you. You know, for example, I spoke about Craig Milverton, who was he was UK jazz pianist of the year a few years ago, and he did his grade 6 and then he quit grades, but you know, he's a phenomenal player. So, you know, if you're within the popular music setting, or you know, you're a great jazz pianist, but you maybe haven't done the classical grades, then do get in touch. Amy Phillips will be on afterwards, our recruiting NCO. You know, please do get in touch with her, and we'll always have a look at people. Whilst we're on that, also hashtag RMBS Masterclass if you want to upload anything of yours. Not sure we'll get time to have a look at it, but do put it up there. So that's kind of where we are with the auditions, really. I would start firing the questions on there now, and we'll try and do a little bit of them as we go if you've got any questions. The audition process shouldn't be daunting. Air Drink Water One. I mentioned at the beginning, I'm a clarinetist as well. Before I joined, I was a flautist, they taught me clarinet from scratch, achieved my grade 8 clarinet within a year, I really enjoy the clarinet. I've had a pound for every time someone's cracked the gag, can you march with the piano, I'd be fairly rich, so clearly we march with the clarinet rather than the piano. I do a lot of marching band stuff, really enjoy the concert band repertoire on clarinet. We often move between the keyboard and the clarinet and do both within a gig as well. That's my other instrument. Again, going back to the audition side of things, if you haven't got a working knowledge of chords, that's a good place to start. You know, if if you have an understanding of a lead sheet, and what can be involved in what you sort of extrapolate from a lead sheet, then that's really quite useful as well. And then, you know, like what I mentioned, the warm-ups at the beginning there, technique work, you know, if you can really sort of hone down and get your skills, you're working every day at your technique and your fingers and all the rest of it, then, you know, that'll really stand you in good stead. And you know what, I guess myself and Rob, we look for different things, and often we look for very similar things as well. And one thing that we both like is, you know, someone who plays from the soul, someone who plays with real passion. You know, if you clip a couple of notes, but you know, you've really sort of, you've played the Beethoven from in here somewhere, you know, that's the sort of person that we want really. You know, rather than a, you know, be very clinical, but there's no kind of passion and emotion to it. So yeah, just play with a lot of conviction to whatever you do. And I think that goes for all the styles that we've mentioned today. You know, play with conviction. And the big thing is just have fun. Have fun playing music. You know, I guess, I mean, we did our sort of encore at the Albert Hall this year was just having lots of fun. I've got another question there from Katie. A few pieces for cocktail repertoire. Some of the ones that are played there. So, you know, get some musicals on there. You know, any music that you like, really. But it's just anything that's pleasant. Any ballads that you enjoy. One thing that I play quite a lot is All of Me. Not the jazz one, but the ballad version. That's really quite nice. A lot of people really quite like listening to Disney, believe it or not. And there's some really good tunes there. So it's just anything that you enjoy playing, I think, is the most important thing. If you enjoy it, you're gonna play it with a lot more passion. And that's ultimately the case really with it. And that's about a lot of what we have to cover. Any other questions coming? Okay, but just while we're waiting to see if there's a final few questions coming through, I'd like to just mention that after I've finished, we'll have our recruiting NCO, Corporal Amy Phillips, and she'll come online and she can answer lots of questions about the wider band service, or about the recruiting process, or any of them sort of questions. Please do hit us up on social media as well. So we're on Facebook, Instagram and Twitter. So you can follow kind of what we're doing and get a bit of an insight into what the life in the Royal Marines Band is all about. You can also visit us at www.royalnavy.mod.uk/RMBS. Or you can email careers@royalmarinesbands.co.uk. And there's a phone number you can also call. I'll do that one a little bit more slowly. That's 07-881-844-632. And they're all ways that we can look into you maybe joining the band service in the future. I've really enjoyed my career, and I wouldn't be the pianist I am without what the Marines have given me in terms of experience, you know, knowledge in terms of tuition, and you know, I just enjoy gigging. I enjoy playing the piano, and I've been all over the world doing it with a really fine bunch of musicians, great camaraderie, and yeah, it's been a lot of fun. Thank you very much for all of you for tuning in. I've had a blast. I hope you've picked up something from it that you can take forward into your normal playing. Thank you very much, and hopefully see you all again soon.